where we take your source materials and really just excavate the essential insights, giving you that shortcut to being well-informed. Today, we're tackling one of the stock market's oldest mysteries, this consistently bullish trend that markets, especially smaller stocks, tend to see right at the beginning of the new year.
It's a phenomenon so reliable it actually got its own name decades ago, the January effect. And for a long time, people looked for, you know, psychological reasons, New Year's optimism, maybe bonus payouts.
Right, the holiday spirit carrying over into trading.
Exactly. But the source material you've shared with us points to something, well, far more calculated and frankly, much more rational.
That's it. Our mission in this deep dive is to move right past that superficial explanation. We want to drill down into this surprising and totally legal tax planning strategy that doesn't just correlate with this effect, it actually causes it.
It's a fantastic case study. It shows how human behavior, when it's driven by a single predictable financial deadline, can create these really reliable market movements.
Yeah, we're going to unpack that clear link between how investors handle their winning stocks and their losing stocks at year end.
All driven by the tax calendar.
And the subsequent surge in buying that really defines early January. Okay, so let's unpack this. Let's start with the fundamental conflict every successful investor faces right now as the year starts to wrap up. You've got a portfolio.
Yeah.
And it's filled with stocks you've done well on, your winners, and, you know, inevitably some that are sitting underwater.
Mm-hmm.
Your losers.
That's just the reality of investing. The problem comes up when you want to lock in a profit. If you sell a winning stock, you recognize a gain.
And that gain is immediately taxable. The government wants its cut.
Right. And taxes are, I mean, they're the ultimate drag on your long-term returns.
Of course. So the name of the game is smart tax planning. Can you give us a concrete example of this liability? Let's use the numbers from the sources.
Sure. Let's imagine a typical scenario. You bought a stock, let's just call it Teva for this example, for $1,000. Mm. It does well, and by December 31st, it's worth $1,100.
So $100
profit. $100
profit.
If you sell that stock, that's what you've recognized. Now, assuming a 25% tax rate, which is a common rate used for capital gains in these sources.
That $100 profit means you now owe $25 to the government. That's your tax bill for just that one trade.
Precisely. So you want that $100 profit, but, well, you don't really want to hand over that $25 tax payment.
So the big question for the investor becomes, what is the legitimate legal way to avoid or at least reduce that $25 bill while still taking the profits you want?
And this is where the strategy and the calendar, they become inseparable. It leads directly to this core strategy we call loss harvesting.
Loss harvesting.
Or what the sources also call legitimate netting. So the investor knows they have that $25 tax liability from their profitable sale. To counteract it, they go hunting in their portfolio for a loser. They intentionally sell a stock that's currently underwater specifically to generate a matching tax offset.
Okay, here's where the math really makes it click. So we still got that $25 tax liability from the Teva sale just hanging over us.
Right. Now, the investor scans their list and finds a different stock. Let's say they bought the second one for $500 and now it's only worth $300.
Okay, so they're down $200 on that one.
Exactly. If they sell that stock, they recognize a $200 loss. And that loss is the crucial element here.
Because if the profit created a tax payment, the loss must create a tax credit, a deduction.
Correct. That $200 loss, calculated at the same 25% rate, generates a tax credit of $50.
Wow. That's incredibly efficient. So you had a $25 tax bill from the gain, but now you have a $50 tax credit from your loss.
And when you net the $25 liability against the $50 credit, the investor ends up paying zero tax on that profitable Teva sale. They've successfully sheltered the profit.
So the sale of that second stock was performed, what, solely for tax sheltering?
Yes, to recognize the loss before the year ends and legally lower their overall tax bill.
So just to be absolutely clear for everyone listening, the motivation for selling that losing stock isn't necessarily that you've lost faith in the company.
Not at all.
It's purely a calendar-driven transaction. It's just to settle your tax account for the year. This timing is really the key, isn't it?
It is entirely a function of the tax deadline. They are using the loss as an accounting tool, and this is a common, totally legitimate tax planning activity. But it's what happens next that really drives the market anomaly.
I could just hear a savvy listener asking right now, okay, if I believe in that losing stock long term and I only sold it for the tax credit, why don't I just buy it back the very next day?
Wait.
Why do I have to wait?
Ah, that is the essential question. And it pushes the discussion beyond simple accounting and into the, well, the legal mechanics of the market. The reason you have to wait is because of something called the wash sale rule.
The wash sale rule.
Yeah.
Okay. This is the mechanism that handcuffs the investor, that forces them to wait. So explain what this rule prevents.
Well, the IRS isn't naive. They recognize that people might try to sell a stock purely for the tax loss and then immediately buy it back.
Which would mean you're not really changing your investment position at all.
Right. You'd be gaming the system. So the wash sale rule prevents this. It disallows the tax deduction if you repurchase a substantially identical security within 30 days, either before or after the sale date.
Okay, so if I sell a stock on, say, December 20th to get that loss,
mm-hmm.
and then I buy it back on December 28th, I lose the tax benefit completely. The IRS basically says, nope, you didn't really commit to selling it.
Precisely. You have to keep that position off your books for at least 31 days. And this 31-day window is why the calendar flip from December to January is so powerful. Investors who are loss harvesting will sell their losers in late November or, much more commonly, late December.
So if they sell on December 1st, they can buy it back in early January and they're clear.
Mm-hmm. But the vast majority of this activity is concentrated in the last few weeks of December. And that's the first half of the market effect, a surge of supply, of selling, as thousands of investors dump stocks they often still believe in just to secure a tax deduction.
And this selling pressure has a real tangible impact,
mm.
right? We aren't talking about, you know, huge blue chip stocks here.
Not usually. Loss harvesting tends to happen more in smaller cap stocks or stocks that have been really beaten down over the year. And that supply surge in December artificially drives down the price of those specific market segments.
And here's where it gets really interesting. Because now the market consequence starts to show. We have this huge concentration of selling in December. But the story doesn't end there. Because the investor only sold that stock to satisfy the tax rule. They might still think it's a great company for the long haul.
That's the pivot. The tax benefit is secured. The prior year is closed. The clock strikes midnight on December 31st and January 1st arrives. It's a completely clean slate. The restriction from the wash sale rule lists for stocks sold 31 days prior.
So what's the immediate coordinated action taken by all those investors who just temporarily dumped their losers?
They buy them back. They held the cash through the deadline. They secured their tax deduction. And now they are free to reestablish the position they believed in all along.
The market reversal. So they buy back the stock they wanted to hold anyway, but just had to get rid of for a minute for the tax benefit.
Exactly. And when this happens on a huge collective scale, when everyone sells those beaten down small cap losers late in December for tax shelter, and then everyone repurchases them almost immediately at the start of the new year.
That sudden concentrated surge of buying demand has to push the prices up.
It does. If you were to look at a chart of small cap indices, you'd often see this dip in December and then a noticeable coordinated jump in January. The collective decision by thousands of individuals all following the same tax calendar creates the January effect.
So that really answers the question the market theorists always ask, doesn't it? If this is so reliable, why hasn't sophisticated arbitrage just eliminated it?
It's a great question. Why hasn't it been arbitraged away? People try. But the answer really lies in the highly behavioral and short-term nature of this whole thing. The tax benefit is personal to each investor. And more importantly, the transaction costs and the sheer unpredictability of exactly which stock will be harvested heavily. It makes pure arbitrage really difficult and risky.
So it's not a fundamental mispricing that a professional can easily exploit. It's more of a weird timing issue driven by regulations.
That's a good way to put it.
So that is the powerful takeaway here. The phenomenon we call the January effect, that predictable market rise, especially in smaller, heavily harvested stocks. It's not random. It is a direct mechanical consequence of thousands of investors making rational end-of-year tax planning decisions.
Decisions which are forced into a specific timing window by the wash sale rule, and then they reverse those decisions as soon as the tax year is over.
It really demonstrates that undeniable connection between, you know, external non-economic factors like tax law and what seem like organic market movements.
Mm-hmm. The tax code is basically dictating a widespread coordinated purchasing behavior, which, in turn, creates a predictable short-term market trend.
It's an incredible look behind the curtain. It shows how regulations can literally dictate the timing of buying and selling, completely separate from the intrinsic value of the company itself.
The January effect isn't magic or some New Year's euphoria. It's just the sound of everyone buying back the stocks they temporarily dumped to save on their tax bill.
And that collective mandatory timing, that is the secret sauce. Without that shared deadline and that shared incentive to legally minimize your tax liability, the buying just wouldn't be concentrated enough in that narrow window to move the indices in such a visible way year after year. It's absolutely fascinating. The next time you see the market spiking in early January, you'll know it's not just optimism. It's tax accounts being settled. It leaves you with this to think about, though. If tax planning drives such a profound and predictable monthly stock movement, what other non-economic behavioral or regulatory deadlines, I don't know, maybe quarterly reporting or seasonal fund distributions, what other things might be secretly influencing the market that we just haven't fully identified or given a catchy name to yet?
The pressure of a deadline is often the hidden hand driving what just looks like organic market volatility. That's definitely worth mulling over.
A great thought to leave you with until our next deep dive. Thanks for joining us.